above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen."
Yeah. risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed.
Well, hallelujah, Christ is risen indeed. We welcome you to worship here at Memorial. We're celebrating Easter in August today. My name is Mark Charles. I'm a senior pastor here at Memorial, and we are glad that you have joined us for worship today. Whether you are with us live on our Facebook feed or on our YouTube channel later on today or later on this week, or if you received one of our Mac Packs and you're watching on DVD, we are glad that you are worshiping with us in these holy and sacred moments together. I do want to invite you today to make sure that you click on the link in our live feed or on our Connect page, www.mumconline.com/connect. And there you will find everything that you need to participate in worship here this morning. You'll also find an attendance form, and you'll be able to sign in, let us know that you are here worshiping with us this morning. I also want to say to you today that if you have a prayer request and you're with us on our live feed, please make sure that you type that prayer request in there, and we will make sure to lift that up in prayer later on this morning, and one of our pastors will pray for you on the live feed just as quickly as they can get to it. This is also a first Sunday, so we will celebrate Holy Communion together. I hope you have your bread or your crackers and your juice prepared at home. If you don't, right now would be a really good time to go and to get all of that ready so that it's there at that moment in the service later on. I also want to take a moment to ask you to invite your friends and your social networks to come and worship with us this morning. Everybody is welcome here at Memorial, and you can do that by finding the share button on our live Facebook feed, clicking on that button, and it will share to all of your friends, and who knows who might join with us for worship here this morning. Pastor Carrie.
And so now it's time to grab your candles as we welcome the light of Christ in our midst here and in, of course, your midst at home. So get light of Christ, be in your space and in our space, and may it shine bright like that resurrection morning for all of us. The light of Christ be with you. And as we have welcomed the light of Christ into our space, I encourage you to share the peace of Christ. Share the peace of Christ with those in your household. Share the peace of Christ on our live community feed. And share the peace of Christ by sending a text or calling someone later. For Christ is risen, and Christ's peace reigns with us. Amen. And let us stand now, and we will sing, Christ is risen indeed.
Earth and heaven for a Savior.
Amen. All right, all of you kids, I want you to come up closer to the screen, and I want your parents to get ready on the community feed, because we're going to play a little game this morning. I've got my phone. I'm going to try to keep up with our guesses, but we're going to play a game. So if you have been out and about, you probably have a mask like this one. This is one of my masks. And when you go out in the grocery store or outside, you probably see a lot of people wearing masks, don't you? So when you wear a mask, it kind of makes it hard to see, doesn't it? See? Do you recognize me? Do you know it's me? No, you don't? It's a surprise? Ha! Just like that game you played when you were a baby. So one of the things in our scripture today is about trying to figure out who this person is. So we're going to play a game. I'm going to show you a video that Dr. Joan shared with me. And I want you to see if you can guess who this person is painting. And so when you guess it, I want your parents to put it in the comment box so we can all see together. All right. It's like one big game of church charades.
At the start,
I think it's fire.
He was there.
I bet it's the burning bush. You think so? Maybe it's a mountain.
He'll be there.
Or a cave. Cave would be perfect for Easter. Did you figure it out? I don't know. All right, let's roll the rest of the video and see if we can see who this person or what this person is painting. All right. Got it? I don't know. It's got different colors. I think it kind of looks like a cave. Do you think it's a cave? Oh, I see somebody's got it. Huh. That is... It's Jesus! Look at that! Did you figure it out? Did it help that he... Oh, Madeline, good job. Congratulations, you figured it out. Did it help when he turned it upside down so it was actually right side up and you could recognize who Jesus was? I don't know about you, but sometimes it's hard for me to recognize Jesus. I don't always see him. I don't always feel close to Jesus. Did you know that that's okay too? But one of the ways that we feel close to Jesus is when we pray, when we talk to other people, and other people in reading our Bible can help us feel like God is there. Today in our scripture passage that Pastor Carrie is going to preach on, we're going to see two of Jesus' disciples who are walking down the road, and Jesus comes and walks next to them, but they don't recognize him. Do you think it's because Jesus was wearing a mask? Probably not. But they actually end up recognizing him at the end of the story when Jesus does something that makes them remember a part of that story. So I want you to pay really close attention a little bit later in the service so that you can try to figure out how do they recognize Jesus and how can you recognize Jesus too. All right? Thanks for playing along. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you so much for Jesus. Even when we don't always see him, we know that he is there. Help us to feel you close by each and every day so that we know that we are not alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor Charlie?
Thanks, Pastor Drew. Every week in our service, we come to this moment where we bring our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings before God. I want to take this opportunity to do two things. First of all, is to say thank you to all of our church family who are giving generously to support the mission and ministry of God through this church, in this community, and much further beyond. And also, secondly, is to remind you that our generosity and our giving makes a difference. It really matters in the world around us. Through it, we are able to partner with our brothers and sisters throughout this community, throughout this world, to help those who really need it. And so I invite you in these few moments to bring your gifts and your offerings before God now. There are a number of ways that you can do that here at Memorial. You can download the Give Plus app to your phone or your device, and you can put in your details there, and you can give in that way. You can also go to our church website, mumconline.com/give, and you can follow the instructions on that web page, and you'll be able to give in that way. Also, if you prefer to write a check, you can mail that check in to the Parton Center here in Center Street, Fernandina Beach. Or if you want, you can drive down and drop it in through the mail slot of the Parton Center. Our giving matters, and our giving makes a difference in this world. We are so thankful for a church that is so generous and giving to the world around it. Why don't we pray together now? And gracious God, as we bring these gifts and these offerings before you today, we ask, Lord God, that you would receive them, that you would multiply them, and that you would bless them for the work and for the building of your kingdom, for the relieving of suffering in the world. And we ask all of that in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And as we give to make a difference in the world around us, we also pray hard to make a difference in the world around us. Would you join with me now in a time of pastoral prayer for our community and for our world? Let us pray together. Gracious God, we are gathered here virtually today once more to remember who you are, to remember who we are, created in your image, set apart and called to join with you in mission and ministry in this world. We gather here to remember that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, and that because of that, we bring all of our prayers just now in great resurrection hope. And so, Lord, we think of the world around us, a world which seems upside down, a world in which it is hard to recognize you and to see your fingerprints, Lord. So open up our eyes, pull away the scales so that we may see you. Open up our ears so that we may hear you, Lord. We pray for a world still in the grips of coronavirus. We ask, Lord God, that your hand would be upon those who lead us. We pray for all of our leaders in this nation. We pray for our president, for our vice president, for the team that work with them, for our state leadership, for our county and city leadership here. We ask, Lord God, that you would grant them wisdom and discernment, that you would give them understanding, Lord God. Give them great empathy for all of those that they lead, so that they would lead in a godly way for the common good. We pray for those, Lord, who are working today furiously around the clock seeking for medications that will help to fight against coronavirus. Lord, for those who are struggling in the world today because of this illness, either physically or who are struggling mentally or emotionally as a result of the impact of coronavirus, Lord, we ask that you would draw close to them. We ask in great faith and great hope that your hand would be upon all of those who are hurting in your world today, that they would know the closeness of your presence, that it would be healing, that it would be encouraging, that it would be uplifting. For those friends in our own congregation who are watching and joining in this moment of worship and prayer today, Lord, would you draw close to them now? However this situation is impacting them, Lord, we ask that they would know the closeness of your presence by the power of your Spirit in this moment. Lord, not only are we facing the impact of coronavirus, we also know that a hurricane is moving right along the coast of Florida today. And so we pray for all of those who are in its way. We pray for the people of the Bahamas who are experiencing it right now as we pray. We pray for our own community and our own state, for those in this nation who will be impacted by weather in the coming hours and days. Lord, draw close. And as we need to help one another, let us be your hands and your feet in the world, Lord, so that we can ease suffering. We pray also for those who are sick in our own congregation or who are known to be sick in our church family today. So we do pray for Bo, who is fighting cancer. We pray for all of our friends who are struggling with depression and with loneliness during this pandemic. We pray for Gene Robinson's father. We ask that you would heal him of his circulation issues. We pray for our dear friend and sister, Sandy, today. We ask that you would resolve the health issues that she is experiencing, that you would ease her pain. We pray for Dee Proctor today, who's dealing with pneumonia. We ask, Lord, that you would come alongside her, give her strength. And for Sue Gilvey, who's in the advanced stages of Alzheimer's, Lord God, would you draw close to her heart? May she know your peace and your comfort in these days, and may those who love her also know that same peace and comfort. Lord Jesus, you invite us to join with you in interceding for the world around you, around us. And so we lift up all of these prayers before you now. We give them to you, trusting in your goodness, trusting in your mercy, trusting in your power, and in your great resurrection hope, which helps us proclaim, where, O death, is your victory? Where thy sting? Lord, we are people of faith, and so we bring these prayers to you in great faith. And we bring them to you in the name of Jesus, who taught us that when we pray, we ought to pray saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Luke chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going into a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, What are you discussing with each other while you walk along? They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days? He asked them, What things? They replied, The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all of the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it was now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then they said to them, Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all of these scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on, but they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went and to stay with him. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" The same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Wow, that was amazing, Jackson. It is a long passage, and you did an excellent job. Thank you. It makes my heart warm to have all people participating in our services, and we have done our best to do that. And so thank you for helping us with that today. So this text, as we said, is long and it has a lot in it, and I thought I'd try to keep it simple. I would do a good old-fashioned three-point sermon. Who remembers just three-point sermons? If you do, I know, just give us a little like button, and we'll know we're together on this. So I have simply selected three things that I really believe God has for us this morning, and I hope that you will agree, and I hope that God will speak to your heart as God has spoken to my heart in preparation. So let us pray before God now. Most holy God, we come before you asking for you to open our minds, our hearts, our spirits, focus us, silence the distractions around us, and help us focus on you and your word today. Let the words of my mouth be your words and not mine. In your name we pray, amen. So in the beginning of our text today, two of Jesus' followers were walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and they were in deep conversation. The word here for conversation is homilio in Greek. I probably said that wrong, and Drew and Charlie will correct me later, and that is fine. We translate that word as homiletics, which is an action of intense discussion. It's actually what we call preaching. Is another word for preaching is homiletics. So this is the kind of discussion that the disciples were deep into as they left Jerusalem on that day. And Jesus walks up behind them, and he says, "Hey, what you talking about?" But they don't recognize him as Jesus. They instead think he is a stranger. And in fact, a peculiar stranger, because he has no clue what has been happening. That the whole town of Jerusalem, which was not a small town, a whole city of Jerusalem we're talking about. They are, in fact, of course, referring to the trial, the crucifixion, and the death of Jesus. And they tell him, this stranger, about all that has happened. And they say, even some of the women went to the tomb this morning, and they said, Jesus' body isn't there. And I can feel, as I read this text, I can feel their disappointment. I can feel the disappointment that they have in Jesus, for they thought that he was the coming Messiah. In the Jewish tradition, there is a large component about searching for a Messiah, and the scriptures point to it throughout all of the Old Testament. And Jesus had come to that time and that place and said, "I am the Son of God. I am here to heal and to save." And they believed him, as we know, of course, that they should have. But then they get to the end of Good Friday, and Jesus has died, and they are disappointed. It is a palpable disappointment that not only do they feel, but I know was all over Jerusalem that day. So it is a nationwide disappointment. I feel like we've probably felt this way before. As I was describing the disappointment, can you think of a time in your life where you have had high hopes for something to work out, where you had built yourself all up, you were all excited, and then it just didn't pan out to be like you thought it would? Or maybe there was a leader that you came to trust and to love and that you wanted to see succeed, and they failed and you were disappointed. That feeling is crushing and is deep in your soul. I have felt this before, and I'm sure that you have too. All of them were disappointed, and it was like a blanket laying over the city. And then Jesus enters in and he says these words, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe that all of the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter his glory?" In this moment, Jesus interrupts their self-pity, their disappointment, and he reminds them of something that they have forgotten. He reminds them that the prophets had predicted the suffering long before, that the Messiah's life would not be easy, but it would be filled with troubles. But they had forgotten this part. And so Jesus comes in and he reminds them of this story. He then continues to walk with them along the road, and he paints them a picture from the scriptures. He starts in the beginning of Genesis, and he goes all the way through to the time where they are now, and he shows them where God was all along and how they fit into the story and how the Messiah fits into the story. And he reminds them that the story is bigger than they are and it is not complete. So the first thing we have from God today is about our disappointment. I don't know if you're anything like me, but when I get disappointed, I get bogged down. It affects my mood, it affects my judgment, and it affects every decision that I make until I shake myself out of the disappointment. And I have a feeling that's how the disciples were. And Jesus comes in and he says, there is more to the story than you're thinking of. He opens their eyes to new ways, and they tell us later that their hearts were burning with the news. So Jesus can come into our lives when we are disappointed, when we have disappointment in our lives and we need a new picture painted for us. We can let Jesus come in and teach us and remind us that our situation, though it is important, is fleeting in the grand scheme of the world, and that even in these moments, God is with us. Isn't that good news? Our second point for today occurs in verses 28 and 29. It says, as they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going. And they urged him strongly, stay with us, because it's almost evening and the day is now nearly over. So he went in to stay with them. And then after talking, Jesus decides he's going to go head on his way. And they say, no, you can't do that. We want you to come and be with us. They offer him hospitality, a meal, and a place to stay. And the Greek word here is, I know I'm going to get this one, parazamai, which I know is wrong, but you can look it up later. But it means to constrain or force, which I'm not going to lie to you is not what I expected. When I looked up the word, they urged him to stay, I thought it would be a gracious extending of welcome. But in fact, the two places it's used in the New Testament, it is to constrain or force something into happening. And so I went and I looked a little deeper into these stories. And I was reminded of the way that the disciples felt. So if you picture yourself and with Jesus, picture the disciples with Jesus. He had opened the scriptures to them and had taught them and guided them, and they were not ready for it to be over. So they offered him a place to be because they could not imagine their time ending with them quite yet. This is similar in the other account of this word in Acts. Paul has just baptized Lydia and her whole family, and she is overwhelmed with gratitude, and she urges Paul to stay in her home. She can't bear the thought of him being away from her just yet. This kind of hospitality reminds me of a question that I know many of you have been asked or pondered. It's a good party question. So if you could pick anyone that is currently alive to eat a meal with, who would that be? Who would you welcome into your home to have a meal with? Now, if you're like me, this is the logic you use to pick the person. You base it on how you have perceived them and how they've impacted your life. And you would work hard to clean your house, to prepare a gourmet meal to their taste and specifications. And this gift would be a thank you for all of the ways that they have impacted and directly helped your life. So who would that be? What are the preparations that you would make to welcome them in? What would you expect to learn from them that night? And this is what I think God wants us to ask us today. So what if that person was Jesus? Would the preparations be the same? Would you welcome them as you welcomed your favorite guest? We are removed from the physical presence of Jesus in our lives, and yet it is important now to find spaces and ways to be open to Jesus, to learn from Jesus. Many people that I have encountered during this pandemic time have said to me, I've just kind of put a pause on all things church related until the building gets back open. I need the building to be in so I can grow. And yet, I don't think that's what God has in this story today. If you notice, the disciples' interaction is not in the tabernacle where they worship, but is in the road on the outside on the way home in a least expected space. God can show up in our lives and meet us anywhere. So today, what are the ways that you are open to God? How are you preparing for and seeking an encounter with the Holy? Have you been one of those who are waiting until you can be back here in this space or in your church? Are there new ways that you can find God now? Oswald Chambers wrote repeatedly in his famous devotional, My Utmost for His Highest, he says that it's not about successful buildings or programs or even faith or sanctification, good works or evangelism. The real end of things is oneness with Jesus. We can't wait for this building to open, though it will. Don't worry, this is not the announcement saying we're not opening. It will open, we will be back together, but we do not want you to wait on your growth with God for that to happen. Our families, your children cannot wait because God is right there where you are. Jesus' disciples were on the road and they were not looking for a holy moment when Jesus entered in, and yet they recognized it and they offered him hospitality and he met them and he taught them. We must be open to God today. And that is point number two. Our third point today that I believe God wants us to hear is about finding ways to open ourselves to God. So we can stand here and say we can be open to God, but what does that look like and how do we do it? And then I'm reminded of the way that Jesus did in this story. When they encountered him on the road, he spoke scripture to them. He taught them from what we would call the Bible. One of the best things we can do in our lives, especially now in the chaos, is to develop daily habits of Bible reading. Trust me, I understand how difficult this can be. I'm a mom with two young children, one of whom is a morning person, one of whom is a night owl. So there's literally never a time when there's not a child by my side when my brain is functioning. I never have quiet time alone. But I can get my scripture reading done when I put my mind to it. And I've developed habits to help myself with this. And when I do this, I always find myself closer to God. God always meets me in the scriptures. And when I don't find time, I feel a distance in my soul. And I don't know if you are the same. The other way we can encounter God that I believe God is telling us today happens in our story when Jesus gets into the home with the disciples. When Jesus sits down, he breaks bread with them. He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And in this act, the disciples' eyes were opened and they recognized him. They got it. The light bulb went off. They knew there was something familiar about him, but they couldn't quite put their finger on it before until that moment. And the moment in the breaking of the bread, they were transported back to just a few days prior when they sat in the upper room with Jesus having the same meal. They didn't understand it then when he told them what was coming. And they didn't even fully understand it then, now, in the breaking of that bread. And yet they had an encounter with God. And we can too. Richard Rohr, who is a Franciscan friar and an author, says, okay, we don't see Jesus anymore, so how do we know that he is present to us? He says he is present in the Eucharist, which is communion. We know him in this celebration and the ongoing appropriate of the story. We can't sit down at the table like the first disciples did, for I wasn't there myself. But we can sit at this new table in our town and experience the Lord's Supper just as they did, and know him just as they did, and our hearts will burn within us. Joining together with other Christians, other people in God's presence is how we can meet God. These ordinary acts of grace, the communion, the singing of hymns, the praying, are the ways that we can meet God. We may not be together in the same room right now, and I understand that. We may not even be worshiping at the same time or on the same day, but we are together. God is bigger than time and space and will meet us in this meal that we will share together. Today's text is a familiar one. The resurrection text that you heard at the beginning of this service is a familiar one. But I am thankful to God for showing us new ways to see this text today. I remind you, the three movements are about disappointment. When we as humans feel ourselves disappointed, maybe at a leader, a friend, a family member, or a situation, we tend to let that disappointment cloud our thinking and ruin our day or weeks. And like the disciples along the road, we talk about it at length with everyone around us. Yet Jesus reminds us in this story that our disappointment is not the whole story. That there is a bigger story that is God's story, and we are welcome to be a part of it. Today we also learned about what the disciples learned about being with Jesus. They needed him, they loved him, they learned from him, and they compelled him to come be in their house. When was the last time you were excited about being with God, about learning from God? When did you invite him into your life? Have you put things on hold? Are you ready to restart? We cannot do this without God, and God is ready for us. And the ways that we can do that are our third point. One is through scripture, reading, and conversation. Pull out your Bible. Have some time with God each and every day. Join one of our classes and join in conversation about that. It will enrich your life. And sit at the table, whether it is this table, whether it is dinner with your family, whatever table it is, engage in conversation. Invite God to be among you, and God will always be there. I don't know where you are today. I don't know which of these points God spoke to your heart. But I encourage you to spend some time thinking and praying and reflecting on how is your relationship with God? How are you in this world? And invite God in to continue to open your heart to God, to others, and to being in God's presence. Pastor Charlie wrote a song for us to hear today. And as he plays it, I want you to spend some time in prayer and let God speak to your heart and encourage you along the way. Let me pray for you. Most holy God, we thank you that you show up to us, that you show up in our lives, and that you remind us that you are constantly with us, though we feel distant and alone. God, I pray for each person hearing your words today, that they sit and root deep in their souls, that you begin to open their eyes and their hearts again so that they can see you, that they can let the disappointment that clouds them lift, that they read their Bible with new eyes and they sit at the table with new excitement and expectation. For God, we are thankful that you show up to each of us. We are thankful that you are in this space right now. And we say, oh God, together that we are here. Amen.
Friends of Jesus walking,
down a long and dirty road, headed for Emmaus. They were burdened with the heavy load of grief and disappointment at what had happened to their Lord. A stranger came beside them and asked them what was wrong. They told him what had happened and wondered how he had not heard. He told them they were foolish for not listening to the word of Moses and the prophets, who said that all of this would take place. They asked him to stay with him. They shared in a meal of grace. But still they didn't know him. They didn't know he was the one. Their Lord, whom they were grieving, was right with them in the sun. He broke some bread before them. Their eyes were opened wide. And just like that, he vanished. They found their friends said he's alive. Since then, we've said, take your seat at the table. We gather to feast. Take your seat at the table, the greatest and the least. Bring your worries, your baggage, your joys and your graces. We'll share them together at the table with Jesus. It's a place where we worship. It's a place where we serve. Place where forgiveness and love will never swerve. Its table means mercy, sacrifice and grace. This table is seeing our God face to face. Your history doesn't matter, where you've been or what you've done. Table, it's a place where we're the same, we are one. Come and share in the body, come and drink from the cup. It's Jesus who invites you to be released in his love. It's a place where we worship, it's a place where we serve. Place where forgiveness and love will never swerve. This table means mercy, sacrifice and grace. This table is seeing our God face to face. This table is seeing our God face to face.
Pastor Carrie has spoken to us this morning about the very fact that God is always with us in all times, in all places. Whatever we are going through, whether we can see God or not, whether we can feel God or not, whether we know it or not, God is with us. John Wesley said himself that the best news of all is that God is with us. We don't know where you are in the world today, what you're living with, what you're going through, but we know that that promise remains the same in all places. And today, in this moment, we are gathered to remember that in the way that Jesus invited us to remember that. It's by taking two simple elements, bread and some juice, and remembering Jesus' body broken for us, and his blood shed for us so that we might know and understand and feel and welcome the truth that God is with us, that God is for us. And if God is for us, then who may be against us? So I'm going to invite you now to get your spaces ready wherever you are. Grab those crackers and that bread. Grab your juice and just cast your eyes upon them for a moment. Take a moment of quietness and stillness as we pray together. Inviting God into this very moment. God, we know our own lives. We know our own brokenness. We know the brokenness of the world. We confess it before you now. And we accept your invitation to this table. So God, in these moments together, as we remember the depth and the breadth and the length of your love for us, wherever we are in the world, may we know your closeness in this moment. We ask that in the name of Jesus. Amen. When Jesus introduced us to the idea of breaking bread together and remembering his life and death and resurrection, he did it in a context where he was gathered with his friends around a table. And on that night, he took a loaf of bread, gave thanks for it, and broke it, and blessed it, and gave it out to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, all of you. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, that night after supper, Jesus took the cup, and he gave thanks for it, and he shared it out amongst his friends who were gathered around that table, saying, "Take and drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you do it in remembrance of me." And ever since that night, and the thousands of years since, Christians have gathered around ordinary tables and celebrated this extraordinary meal. We do that again today, virtually, wherever you are. In just a few moments, I'm going to invite our staff team who are here this morning to come and kneel around our altar area here, where they will share in Holy Communion together. We pray that these elements would become for us the body and blood of Christ. We pray that the elements, wherever you are today, would become for you the body and blood of Christ, and that we may each know the freedom of Christ as we partake of this holy meal. Please remember today that this table is open for everyone. Everyone is welcome. You don't need to be Methodist or Episcopalian or Catholic or Baptist or Presbyterian or anything else. What matters is that you're here at the invitation of Jesus, because this is his table today, even that table in your home. So gather around it now. Partake of this bread and of this juice, and remember the death and the glorious resurrection of Christ, which is giving you and me and all of us life in all of its fullness today. We gather now to share in this meal. Staff, if you want to come and join me here. Body of Christ broken for us. And the blood of Christ that was shed for us.
God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us, in which you reveal yourself to us again. make these elements be for us your body and your blood, so we may be your disciples, helping make you known in this world and overcoming the power of brokenness that we see all around us. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Dear friends, that brings us to the end of our worship service here today. We want to thank you again for joining us in these holy moments together. I hope that your soul has been fed. I hope that you have been reminded once again that God is with you wherever you are today. We do want to invite you to join us again next week on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock on Facebook Live or afterwards on YouTube. And we will be joined by Derek Scott, our campus ministry leader here right in the Northeast District, the leader of CCW. And Derek will join us. His band will prepare some worship music to bring and to share with us by video. And we're very excited to join with them for that moment next week. Please join with us in this benediction.
May the loving power of God, which raised Jesus to new life,
strengthen you in hope,
enrich you with his love,
and fill you with joy in the faith.
Amen.
What a glorious way, what a glorious way.